Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for attending my thesis defense. The title of my thesis is Identifying Tweets with Implicit Entity Mentions. First of all, I'd like to thank my advisor, Dr. Sheth, and my committee members, Dr. Prasad and Dr. Banerjee. I'd also like to thank my collaborator, Sujan Pereira. Sujan had addressed in his dissertation the topic of implicit entity linking, which aims at linking tweets which have implicit entity mentions of a particular entity type to a knowledge base. For example, given a tweet like Andy also thought that space movie with Sandra Bullock was good too. This tweet has an implicit entity mention of a movie, and given such a tweet to his algorithm will say that the implicit entity mention is that of movie Gravity. And similarly, the second tweet has an implicit entity mention of the movie Wolf of Wall Street. So when you look at it broadly, given tweets with implicit entity mention of an interested entity type, to the algorithm, it will predict what is the implicit entity mention. Two. However, to identify tweets which have implicit entity mention, he used a naive keyword-based filtering approach. For example, he used film and the keywords movie and film for the tweets which have implicit entity mentions of movies, and book and novel for the tweets which have implicit entity mentions of books. However, this can lead to a scenario like this. No space movie is complete without Starman by Ziggy Stardust. So this tweet does not have any implicit entity mention. However, given such a tweet to the algorithm, it will predict that this tweet has, it will link this tweet to the movie Gravity, which is actually not true. So to solve this problem, we came up with the problem definition that identify tweets with implicit entity mentions of interested entity types. What it means is, given an interested entity type like movie and a tweet saying Andy also thought that space movie with Sandra Bullock was good too, what I try to say is, does this tweet have an implicit entity mention of the type movie? So we...
But the Gravity was of the type movie anyway.
Yes.
So you said that is wrong. You said that was wrong, right?
No, this is right. So given such a tweet, I'll say it has. If it does not have an implicit entity mention, I'll say it does not have. So I'll just filter tweets which have implicit entity mentions. So we take a two-step approach to solve this problem. In the first step, we take as input the entity type of interest, for example, movie or book, and a stream of tweets, and filter out tweets for each interested entity type. For example, these three tweets might have potential implicit entity mentions of the type movie. It is not necessary that all of them have implicit entity mentions, but we filter out all these tweets. In the second step, we take all these tweets from the first step and classify them into one of the three classes, that is implicit, explicit, and null. I'll be explaining each of the steps in detail in the future slide. So let's start with the filtering algorithm. So the intuition behind filtering tweets is, every tweet which has an implicit entity mention will contain at least one term which acts as the semantic cue of the entity type. So what I mean by this is, if you take a look at the first tweet, I found it kind of neat that the real Jordan Belfort shows up, who this movie is based on. This tweet has the term movie, which indicates that this tweet might have a potential implicit entity of the type movie. Similarly, the second tweet has the term thriller, and the third tweet has the term flick. We call these terms as semantic cues. So semantic cues are terms which indicate the presence of an implicit entity of a particular entity type. There are two kinds of semantic cues. First is the formal, that is, we can find these terms in any dictionary.
Okay. So the semantic cues themselves are not guaranteeing you anything, right?
No. They are guaranteeing that it might have an... So whenever a tweet has an implicit entity mention, they need to have the semantic cue. But not all the tweets which have semantic cues have implicit entity mentions. So that is what I'm saying. So all implicit tweets have semantic cues, but not all tweets with semantic cues have implicit mentions.
You can't be sure that 100% of the tweets that have implicit entities would have semantic cues.
I cannot think of a scenario where this is not true, but when you go to different entity types like actor, the abstraction level changes. Like, instead of saying an actor, a person, someone can say a guy, but you always mention that entity type when you're talking about an entity implicitly. So when I'm talking about movie and I do not specify the name of the movie, there'll always be something which says that I'm talking about a movie. Otherwise, how will I tell you that I watched a movie I need to use something. Either
Right, but would those... is there a finite number of those terms?
No, there are infinite number of those terms. We try to collect as much as possible.
Right.
We could try to collect as much as possible, like formal and informal, as much as possible. But there is no way to say that this is the finite set, right?
Certainly.
It can keep on growing. Tomorrow someone can come up with a new slang for representing movie that we have never heard of. Probably we'll have to so we'll probably have to capture that as well in the future. So semantic cues are of two types. First is the formal set, which is which can be found in most of the dictionaries, like movie, film, biopic, thriller, directorial, and sequel. And second is informal, which is used in Twitter slang, on Twitter communications and internet slang, for example, flick, rom-com, chick flick, and movie. So the idea is to capture all of both these kinds and all of these terms as much as possible so that we can improve the recall of the algorithm. So let me start by explaining the formal semantic cues. So in order to find formal semantic cues, we use the Wikipedia categories. The reason is Wikipedia categories of an entity contain semantic cues to the entity type. Now, what I mean by this is, given these are two movies, Guardians of the Galaxy and Furious 7, and this is a subset of the categories of these entities. Now, the terms highlighted in green are actually the semantic cues of entity type movie. So films, comedy, action, screenplays, thriller, sequel, all these terms can be used in the context of movies. However, not all these terms in the categories are semantic cues. For example, 2010's American, James Gunn directed, Revenge, Record Progressions, none of them are semantic cues. So there, when we took a closer look at these categories, we identified that the head nouns of these categories were mostly the semantic cues of the entity type. So a head noun is the root term of a noun phrase. They have been traditionally used in question answering systems to identify the focus terms. For example, given a question like what is Hawaii State Flower, a head noun detection algorithm will say that flower is the head noun, and we can say that is the focus term of the question. And similarly, we say that American films, the head noun is films, so the semantic cue is films. It talks about the entity type film. However, a Wikipedia category can have multiple head nouns in itself, and each Wikipedia category can have multiple noun phrases, and each noun phrase can have a head noun of its own. So we assume we take the longest noun phrase and take the head noun of the longest noun phrase as a semantic cue. Now, considering only these head nouns will not always help us. For example, record progressions. This is a category of the movie Furious 7. So if you just use the head noun extraction algorithm, it will say that progressions is a semantic cue, which is not the case. So we needed a mechanism to find a set of head nouns which are actually relevant to the entity type.
So this is a Wikipedia category?
This is a Wikipedia category of the movie Furious 7. And the one in red is some head noun of that category. So in order to say that this head noun does not actually make sense to the entity type movie, we needed a base representation of the movie entity type. So how we did it is, we took all the categories of Wikipedia movies, took all the head nouns, and hypothesized that the term with the highest frequency is the best representation of the entity type. In this case, it is films. So once we have this base term, we compare all this base term with all the other head nouns using a semantic similarity metric and say that the ones below 0.5 are not relevant and ones above 0.5 are the semantic cues which we are looking at. So in order to calculate semantic similarity, we trained a Skipgram model on the Wikipedia 2014 term. Our data sets are from 2014, so we trained a Skipgram model on the Wikipedia 2014 term. Yes. So with this, we extract a set of head nouns, a set of semantic cues from Wikipedia, which we call as formal. But however, there is second type of semantic cues, and those are used on a daily basis on social media messages like flick and movie. Flick, you can encounter the term flick on Wikipedia. However, this term will not be probably used in the movie context, and the term movie, you will not encounter this term on Wikipedia at all. So we needed to try to get as many of these terms as possible. So since these terms are used on Twitter, we used a Twitter corpus to identify these terms.
So you would have this In this case, this movie has three E's, but there may be some usages with four E's and
yes, so
two E's. So you were able to look at all of them and look at the frequency and then decide whether to include them or not include them as informal use.
So yeah, it's kind of I have done that. So what I did is I streamed all. I'll tell you like in the next slide. I explain how I did extract all these terms by myself. So yeah. So what I did is. So the intuition behind doing this is if there is a semantic cue used, which is relevant to the entity type movie, it'll mostly be used in the context of a movie. So how do we get tweets which talk about movies? We streamed tweets using explicit movie names itself. We streamed tweets using Guardians of the Galaxy and Gravity, for example. And these are a couple of tweets which might occur if you use those keywords. And what we do is remove the entity mentions from these tweets because we do not need these terms. And once we once we remove these entity mentions, what we do is we clean the tweets and we tokenize these tweets. So this is a bunch of terms which might be semantic cues or which might not be semantic cues. So again, we need a semantic similarity metric which says that which of them are actually relevant to the entity type and which are actually not. So since the tokens are coming from Twitter, we use a Word2Vec model created on Twitter corpus itself. So Godin et al. 2014 created a Twitter skipgram model trained on 400 million tweets collected between February 2013 and December 2013. So we use this model created using the Twitter corpus and this set of tokens and the base term collected from the previous step, the base term for each entity type, and compare the semantic similarity, and we say whichever is above 0.5 is the set of semantic cues we are interested in, and whichever is below 0.5 is not what we are looking at. So once we do both these steps, we can say that the ones in green are the semantic cues extracted from Wikipedia, and the ones in blue are the semantic cues that we extracted from Twitter corpus. So this set, can keep on growing. Tomorrow maybe someone will come up with a new way to describe the movie and we might be able to capture that. So once we have extracted the semantic cues, what we can do is we can stream all the tweets for using those semantic cues, but it is not necessary that all of these tweets will have implicit entity mentions. For example, the first tweet, Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hardy in a badass revenge flick, has an implicit entity mention of a movie. It talks about the movie Revenant. The second tweet, Shawshank Redemption, what an amazing film, does not have an implicit entity mention of a movie. It has an explicit entity mention, Shawshank Redemption. And the third tweet, I went to the movie with my friends. This has a semantic cue movie, but it does not have an implicit or an explicit entity mention of a movie. It has no mentions, no entity mentions at all. So we treat this as a classification problem, and given each input tweet, we classify it into one of the three classes. Implicit class, the tweet has an implicit entity mention of an interested entity type. The explicit class, the tweet has an explicit entity mention of the interested entity type. And null class, that is the tweet does not have any entity mention, implicit or explicit, of the interested entity type. So we use, in order to solve this classification problem, we use a set of five features. The first feature that we use is the domain relevant entities that are extracted from DBpedia. The second feature that we use is domain relevant entities extracted from Wikipedia. The third is we check if a tweet has an explicit entity name of the interested entity type. For example, if we are looking at movies, we check if the tweet has a movie entity mention. We use bigrams, and the last one we use is posters. So I'll be walking through all of these features in the next slide. Let's start with the first feature, domain relevant entities. So domain relevant entities are entities that can be used to indicate the presence of an implicit entity mention. For example, if you given such a tweet, Jordan Belfort announcing Leonardo DiCaprio's Jordan Belfort, the only way to end this movie, a human annotator can read this tweet and using the presence of Jordan Belfort and Leonardo DiCaprio, he can say that this tweet has a mention of a movie, and he can say that this tweet has an implicit mention of a movie. So this is what we call as domain relevant entities. Entities which are actually relevant to the entity type of interest, for example, movie. Jordan Belfort is a character in a movie, and Leonardo DiCaprio is an actor was acted in a lot of movies. So these are the domain-relevant entities, that what we mean by domain-relevant entities. So the first feature is domain-relevant entities extracted from DBpedia. So DBpedia is a structured knowledge base, and this is a subgraph of DBpedia. We have a couple of movies, Guardians of the Galaxy and Wolf of Wall Street, and these are the entities that are related to these movies using named relationships. There are six unique relationships here: director, producer, country, distributor, starring, and language. But however, if you look at this graph, you can say that not all these relationships are equally relevant to the entity type. Some of them are very generic, and some of them are specific to the entity type movie. For example, director, distributor, producer, and starring are specific to the entity type movie, while country and language are very generic relationships. So the idea is to eliminate these generic relationships and only capture the specific ones. So how we do this is extract all the entities of the interested entity type. So if you are looking at movies, extract all the movies from DBpedia. These are three movies: Guardians of the Galaxy, Wolf of Wall Street, and Fault in Our Stars. Once we extract all these movies, we extract all the relationships and the entities that are connected to the movies using these relationships. For example, director, James Gunn, country, United States, starring, Leonardo DiCaprio, and language, English. These are four of the entities that are related to these movie entities. And then what we do is we take one relation at a time and say director occurred with movies 1,000 times, and in overall DBpedia it occurred 1,100 times. So we say that 1,000 divided by 1,100, and this is the scores that we get. So we rank these scores, we rank each relationship using these PMI scores and take the top 15 relationships for each entity type. So now we have a set of relationships, and whatever entities are connected to movies using these relationships are our domain relevant entities, and we have extracted them from DBpedia. But however, using DBpedia has its drawbacks. It has a couple of drawbacks. The first drawback is not all the relationships are present in DBpedia. For example, Chris Pratt is an actor who has starred in Guardians of the Galaxy. He played the lead role in Guardians of the Galaxy, but that relationship is not present in DBpedia. And the second is the entity itself might not be present in DBpedia. For example, Jordan Belfort, he is a character on whom the Wolf of Wall Street is based on, and this entity, Jordan Belfort himself, is not present. To solve this problem, we use a much more comprehensive knowledge base of Wikipedia and extract domain-relevant entities from Wikipedia, which becomes our second feature. So, domain-relevant entities extracted from Wikipedia. So, given a Wikipedia page, there are always internal hyperlinks to other Wikipedia pages which might be relevant to the page at hand. For example, there are internal links to John Green, Shailene Woodley, and Ansel Elgort. So we say that we consider all the internal links of all the pages of an entity type as domain-relevant entities. But again, the problem is not all of these entities are actually relevant to the entity type. For example, Amsterdam, Indianapolis, Indiana, Pittsburgh, and Pennsylvania do not make sense when it comes to movies. However, we have entities like Shailene Woodley, Ansel Elgort, Josh Boone, Nat Wolff, Sam Trammell, and William Dafoe, which are actually relevant to the entity type movie. So the idea is to eliminate all the irrelevant ones and score all the entities based on their relevance. So we use the Wikipedia hyperlink structure itself to do this. We start with all the movies in Wikipedia. This is a subgraph of that. We take a couple of movies, Guardians of the Galaxy and Wolf of Wall Street. Go to each of their introduction paragraphs and collect all the entities from there. So these are six of the entities that are mentioned on the introduction paragraph. Once we have this, what we do, we draw the outgoing hyperlinks, and then we go to each of these entity pages and draw outgoing hyperlinks. So if there is a new page, if there is a new entity X which is related to Jordan Belfort but not to any movie, we do not consider it because it is two hops away, and we say that it is not relevant. So now we have all this hyperlink graph for each entity type. The idea is to score each entity according to the relevance to the entity type. If you visualize this graph, you can see that United States and Ensemble Cast are actually not relevant to the entity type movie, but Leonardo DiCaprio, Jordan Belfort, Chris Pratt, and Zoe Saldana actually are relevant to the entity type movie. So all the relevant entities have at least one backlink to movies, but all the irrelevant entities actually have zero backlinks to movies. So what we use this intuition and develop a score called as normalized out degree. What we do is for each entity, which is not a movie, we see how many outgoing links are there and how many of those outgoing links are to movies. In this case of Jordan Belfort, there is one outgoing link to movie and there are two outgoing links overall. So we say 1 divided by 2, Jordan Belfort gets a score of 0.5, and Zoe Saldana has one outgoing link and that is to a movie. And we say her score is 1. So that is how we generate, score each entity and say this is the relevance of that entity to that entity type. So with this, we have extracted entities from Wikipedia which with a score of their relevance to the entity type. So this is our second feature. Now, moving on to the other feature that we use for the classification step, we check if there is any explicit entity names. In this case, since we are looking at movies, we check if there is any explicit movie name in the tweet. In this case, Guardians of Galaxy is an explicit mention of a movie. The next feature we use is bigrams. So love the last movie of Lord of the Rings trilogy. So this has an implicit entity mention. However, Lord of the Rings in itself is a movie. So to capture this intuition, we extract bigrams from either sides of the semantic cue that we use to extract the tweet. So in this case, the semantic cue is movie. We extract the last and after. The idea was the last. Usually when you're talking about some entity implicitly, there are cases where you say the last movie or the third book or something like that. So it usually comes before the semantic cue, and we capture that bigrams. And
So why does the bigram box, is it comprehensive? Why is just the bigram? And what are all the sets that of those 2 grams that you compare with?
So we extracted some good ones like the last movie and the third book and the third book of the series or the last movie of the trilogy. Things like that.
Yeah, but third book and third book of the series, so there are 2 different alternatives.
Right.
And you will only get the third book, hopefully.
No, but I get third.
You will not even get third book of the series because you will not get third book because it is not next to the movie or your town that you look surrounding.
Mm-hmm.
So how does that work?
After looking at our data set, so all the a lot of tweets, the inference was that whenever they are using such terms, it usually comes before the semantic cue. Most of the times, I would say it comes before the semantic cue, and that is
so
why
did you measure that quantitatively, what percent of time it is? Recall for this strategy?
I haven't measured quantitatively, there is no experiment that I've done, but I have looked over 2000 to 3000 tweets, and wherever I've seen such examples, it always occurs before a semantic cue. So that is why I just extracted these terms in general. So the next feature that we use is post tags, and so the reason for using this is, suppose you're given a tweet like you will know a Steven Spielberg movie when you see one. So this tweet has the domain relevant entity Steven Spielberg, who's a director. But this tweet actually does not have an implicit entity mention. It has no entity mention, basically. But if you just use domain relevant entities, this will get classified as a tweet with an implicit entity mention. To capture this, we use post tags, and in specific, we use post tags before the semantic cue. So in this case, the post tag determiner A actually makes a difference. So whenever there is post tag like this, determiner A, determiner AN, it more tends to show that the tweet has a null mention, and when there is something like determiner they or adjectives and nouns and verbs, it tends to say that it is more towards the implicit class. So these are the set of 5 features that we use for the classification step. Now that I have explained these 5 features, let me explain, given a tweet, how do we extract all these 5 features? So let's take an example tweet. Leonardo DiCaprio plays an outstanding performance as Jordan Belfort, Holy, The Wolf of Wall Street is a movie I recommend to watch. So the first feature that we use is domain relevant entities extracted from DBpedia. And in order to do I recognize entities in tweets. We replicate a very strong baseline. What we do is we split each tweet into n-grams and check if any of the n-grams is an anchor text on Wikipedia. So in this case, we see that Leonardo DiCaprio is an anchor text on Wikipedia. We say how many times has Leonardo DiCaprio appeared as an anchor text on Wikipedia? That is 1,374 times. How many pages do these anchor texts link to? And all the 1,374 times, this anchor text links to Leonardo DiCaprio, the actor. So we say that it has a 100% probability, a 1% chance, we measure a commonness score of 1 and say that it has a 100% probability that this tweet segment is talking about Leonardo DiCaprio, and Leonardo DiCaprio is a domain relevant entity that we extracted from the Wikipedia. We again split this tweet recursively, and we get the second snippet that we get is Jordan Belfort. There are 123 mentions of Jordan Belfort as an anchor text on Wikipedia. And all those 123 mentions are to Jordan Belfort, the person. In this case, Jordan Belfort, the entity, is not, we cannot extract it from Wikipedia because he's not present on Wikipedia. So we check if this entity is present on Wikipedia, is present in the domain relevant entity set of Wikipedia. And yes, it is. And it has, we say 100% probability that it is actually that entity. And for each entity that is extracted from Wikipedia, we have a score of out degree. We say that Jordan Belfort has a 50% chance that it is a domain relevant entity of movies. So this is the out degree score. Now we just do a simple multiplication saying that Jordan Belfort being Jordan Belfort is 100%, that Jordan Belfort being related to movies is 50%. So the total score is 50%. And that's how we get the second score of 0.5. We again recursively split the tweet and check if there is any movie mentions. In this case, Wolf of Wall Street is an anchor text in Wikipedia again. It occurs 517 times on Wikipedia, out of which for 95 times it occurs as the book and 422 times it occurs as the movie. So we say it has a 0.816 score of being the movie, and we capture that as the score. And then we capture the semantic cues on either side of the, capture the bigrams on either side of the semantic cues, and we use the post tag of the term before the semantic cue, excuse me. So this is how we extract features for each incoming tweet. And with this, I have explained how we identify semantic cues for each entity type, for movies and for books or for any other entity, and stream those tweets. And then once we stream those tweets, how to classify each of these tweets into one of the three classes, implicit, explicit, or null, using a set of five features. Now let me explain to you how we evaluated this approach. So there's no standard state-of-the-art dataset available to evaluate this. So we collected tweets during August 2014 using four keywords: movie, film, book, and novel. And we use Wikipedia and Wikipedia snapshots of May 2014. And these are the statistics for tweets with each class, 420, 179, 385.
So can you say again, I had asked yesterday the question, why 2014?
So we used 2014 because me and Sujan did this work together, and he wanted to study the temporal features of that as well. So he used 2015 tweets for his temporal study, and I used 2014 for, both of us used 2014 for our work itself. On both the papers, we worked on 2014 tweets. So once we have these tweets, we use tenfold cross-validation with all the features, and we train a random forest classifier and study the precision and recall of all the classes. We get a 0.624 F score on implicit entities on the books entity type, and 0.593 F score on the implicit class on movies. And one of the scores that I like is the F score of the null class, because if the null class gets annotated wrongly, the more noisy tweets will be given to the linking algorithm, and the more the effect will be on the linking algorithm. So that performs pretty well on the null class. We get a 0.743 F score on the null class and 683 F score on the null class of movies. Next evaluation that we do is we study the impact of the top K relationship selected. So when we were selecting domain relevant entities from DBpedia, we selected top 15 relationships for each entity type. And here we study the what would have happened if we selected only the top 5, 10, 15 or 20 relationships for each entity type. So when we, as we can see, if we select top 5 for movie or books, the F score is low because we have less number of domain relevant entities, we are not capturing all of them. Again, as we move to 10, the number of domain relevant entities increase and the score goes up. In as we move from 10 to 15, in movies it goes up, but in books it just goes down by 0.001. There is one that is only going a little down, and as we go from 15 to 20, the score goes further down because we extract more noisy domain relevant entities. Like United States comes up as a domain relevant entity if we take the top 20 relationships, and that is not acceptable. So that is why we stuck to 15 relationships. And then one of the most important feature that we used is knowledge extracted from Wikipedia and knowledge extracted from DBpedia. So we wanted to study what would happen if we just use Wikipedia or if we just use DBpedia along with the rest of the features. So there we exclude in the blue. The blue line shows the score when we do not use Wikipedia, and the red line shows when we use Wikipedia and all everything else. And here we show the blue line shows what happens when we do not use DBpedia and what happens when we use DBpedia. So the biggest from this graph we can see that if we do not use DBpedia, the implicit class of books has a F score of 0.57 and that has a score of 0.59. The reason is Nicholas Sparks, who is an author in the for books, he does not get picked up as a domain relevant entity when we use Wikipedia. So that is a problem because there is no outgoing link to any book at all from Nicholas Sparks page, from the introduction section of Nicholas Sparks page. Actually, he has a lot of outgoing. And the last evaluation that we do is, now that we have collected tweets using only four keywords, movie, film for the movies, and books and novels for books, we wanted to see how this model that we created would work if we stream tweets using other keywords like thriller and a biopic or something like that. So what we did is we streamed tweets using all the other keywords apart from these four keywords and used that model that we created as a training data set and this as a test data set to check if our classifier is independent of the semantic cues. And actually they are independent. It is independent of the semantic cues. For each entity type, we'll have to build a classifier of our own, but they are actually independent. We get reasonably good performances on all the three classes. And that leads to our conclusion that, so basically in this work, we presented a two-step approach for identifying tweets with implicit entity mentions of an interested entity type. We introduced a method to identify semantic cues, created gold standard data sets for two entity types, books and movies, and investigated the impact of knowledge extracted from two knowledge sources on the classification step, Wikipedia and DBpedia. And in future, we would like to identify text segments in tweets that indicate the presence of an implicit entity mention. Right now, we just say whether the tweet has an implicit, explicit or null mention. We do not say that this is the segment that indicates the implicit mention. In future, we would like to do that. And we would like to explore more domain-specific knowledge bases for each entity type, like Rotten Tomatoes for movies and Goodreads for books. Right now, we are just using generic knowledge bases which can support any entity type. Maybe we can use domain-specific knowledge bases and explore more knowledge-driven features to enhance the performance of the classification step. So this is what we do like to do as a future work. And finally, I'd like to thank my advisor, Dr. Sheth, for giving me this opportunity, and my committee members, Dr. Prasad and Dr. Banerjee, and for Sujan to help me finishing this thesis really fast, otherwise I would have been here for probably a semester more. And for all you guys, I don't think Manas is there on the photo, so, but thanks for everything. I'm open to questions.
questions, guys?
Can you move to slide 26?
Yeah.
Yeah. So actually, I want to know whether you apply the pre-processing for text before building the classifier.
Yeah. So we do the regular. I do the regular pre-processing for like remove emoticons and punctuations and normalized numbers and all that. And specifically for PO stacks, when I check for the PO stack before the semantic queue, but in this case, this is actually an entity, right? Steven Spielberg is an entity. So I do not check the PO stack of this entity. I go the term before the entity. So I remove all the entity mentions in case of post stacks. Otherwise, the regular pre-processing steps are the only things that I do.
So how about stop word?
Yeah, you're not doing stop word.
I don't remove. Do stop word remove.
I think he needs them for
the post.
So coming back to your earlier, the first example, is that null case?
Which one?
Just go back. I think the very first one that you showed. I think it had some Z, word
of
Z,
okay.
Like Zigman or... So that's supposed to be...
Yeah, this is a null tweet. So, I don't think Ziggy Stardust is actually not a domain relevant entity for movies. But there's actually, if you give this because of space movie, the algorithm will say that gravity is what it is ranked.
But with your approach now, it will not pick that up, right?
It'll say it as null.
It'll
say it as null and it'll never go to the linking step. It'll just get pruned out there.
I have a question. I mean, I asked you this yesterday, but the answer was more directed towards you, Sujan. So that's why I thought I'll bring it up today. So the question was the domain. So you guys started with the books and movie domain, and we clearly saw your difference before it. So that's why this question came up. But now your focus has been in the healthcare field. So how much of these approaches do you think can transfer to a healthcare domain? For example, we are now looking at Twitter data for the asthma project. So would we be able to capture similar implicit mentions within that context, or will it be noisier, or what's going to happen there?
So here he has the idea of semantic cues.
Mm-hmm.
And when we studying the domain, we figured that out, like the semantic cues helps. But there are some domains, the semantic cues have two things can happen. You may not have a semantic cue for some entity types, and for some entity types, it can go up and down. Like as you said, like actor, you won't necessarily say that the actor. Let's say the Sandra Bullock, right? The actress. So some people will tweet it actress, some people will say the lady or something, right? So I have seen tweets like that, that goes up. So the problem is when they use terms like guy and all those things, our confidence on the whether it has the entity goes down. He did the experiment on, not on abstractor, but different semantic types. So whenever there are some noisy keywords like that. When it comes to healthcare, so if you remember my healthcare thing, I do find the keyword type of thing, but that is not like semantic, it's not like type, it's not semantic. He focused on the type, but my thing was I was looking at the entity, and each entity I can find some physiological observational kind of thing acting as something like semantic cue. But it's not type level. It is in each entity level. So the semantic cues, when you go to the healthcare domain, depends on each entity itself, not on the type. So that's something we need. If you are studying on asthma, we need to find out, okay, what is those terms that can indicate the entity rather than entity type.
Do you think the general category types like symptoms and diagnosis, those kind of stuff could help there?
Terms like symptoms and diagnosis?
Or terms that are indicative of symptoms. I feel I seems to have come down with some other terms that may be indicative of those particular things. I took and medication. So, you know, the domain has specific things, right? Intentions or...
So, the only problem I would see, like, we can imagine that they can help. But the noise level that it takes when you collect the tweets, the whole purpose is to collect the data set, right? So, whenever we are going away from the domain specificity, then the noise will come, like so many things you can feel, right? So, how can we certain that, okay, it has the healthcare entity or something like that, but
you could use classification to get the specificity.
Yeah, then we have come up with a different technique to filter out the, from the collected tweets, which are not in our domain. Here we are in the domain, right? So,
see, you are scoring for the entity representative terms for your medical field, right? So we need to do that kind of scoring.
Exactly. Like, I had explained inflammation example, right? If you search based on inflammation, like so many things come up. So when we switch to appendix, then the data set is very clear. So those things we have to attend case by case when it comes to healthcare, entity by entity.
Maybe you can collect the terms and the definition of the disease. Like, for example, you said you go back to the definition, I remember.
Yeah.
And then we can collect those terms, right? And then you can search for them in the tweet and then give a confidence score, right? Something like this.
Yeah, so if it is coming from definition, we have a little bit higher confidence, but still definitions can give you sometimes like the information it was in the definition. Mm-hmm. But it's too broad to do filtering. So that's my feeling.
No, I have another question. So in Sujan's work, right, so he uses anchor text to identify the implicit reference.
He
synthesizes anchor text to actually look for implicit references and then delimit that in the tweets and then finally link it.
Right.
But you seem to say that's part of your future work. So you do not see anchor text as helping with types.
Correct me if I'm wrong. So what Sujan does is he streams tweets using movie, film for movies and book and novel for books. And he runs a spotter on that, like DBPDI spotlight, for example. Right. And if the entity linking algorithm says Guardians of Galaxy film, then that tweet has an explicit mention of Guardians of Galaxy.
Right.
So he does not consider that tweet into his linking algorithm because it has an explicit movie. But if there is a tweet like, I went to movie, it will not have any entity. Or what a great flick by Jamie Vardy, which is actually a football tweet. Jamie Vardy is a sportsman. So Jamie Vardy will get linked, but it is not a movie again. So both these kinds of tweet will go to his linking algorithm, and he will consider that these tweets have implicit mentions, and he will link it, irrespective of whether they actually have it or not.
No, the question that I'm asking is, so you have already filtered for him tweets that contain implicit references.
Right.
But we still need to delimit the phrase that potentially can be linked to an explicit entity. Movie.
Right.
And he uses the anchor text to help you out, to delimit that phrase that will actually link to the explicit reference.
Yes, so I...
So that works for instance level in his case.
Right.
So the question to you is, you are not dealing at instance level, you're dealing at type level.
I'm dealing at only at type.
And so at the type level, I'm sure you must have considered that, and you said that is still future work. So you do not see much promise in anchor text.
So the first, whenever he used the first paragraph of the tweet, the Wikipedia, he gets some anchor text, right? The first paragraph will have the anchor text.
Right.
So those things has higher probability of being relevant to the domain. So one thing to notice is he doesn't have temporal aspect because he's not in the instance level, right? So if he know about the domain itself is enough. So that's why he can do it in the Wikipedia first paragraph level. If you look at there, those are the anchor texts again. So he's dealing with the anchor text, but he does not have the total, like the everything in the all that. In my work, I use all the anchor text. That's how I get ISRO kind of thing, right? Because it's not on the domain, but still it's anchor text. That's how I identify. He does not have to deal with that problem because temporal topics are not really relevant to him. So he'll say, okay, these are the types. Of course, he may be missing some tweets which has the type, which does not have the which are not coming, the knowledge is out of the first paragraph. Then it's synonymous, but he still uses a subset of anchor text and try to be in the type level, not going into the instance level.
So when you're using commonness measure to rank the nodes, have you tried other centrality based measures?
Yes.
Why did you pick commonness?
Yes, so for this, right, out degree. So I used out degree to rank each node, and the other metric that I used was a very was of
between a centrality. So between a centrality is a metric which says that in any graph, the higher the score of a node, higher the between a centrality score of a node, the more the relevance of that node. So but however, when I actually did between a centrality on movies, the node with the highest score was Northern Ireland, and then second was United Kingdom, and third was United States. So the assumption is between a centrality checks how many shortest paths go through that particular node. So there might be, since United States, there are a lot of incoming links, there might be a lot of our shortest paths through United States and through Northern Ireland and through United Kingdom, and that is why they get higher scores. And they did not reflect what was there in, what was intuitive to me. And so I did not pursued, I did it, check the scores, and I knew it wouldn't work at all because Leonardo DiCaprio had got a score of 0.0002 something, so it was completely off. So I just ignored that and I went ahead with out degree.
So if you have very popular node, you'll get into trouble, and basically what you're saying.
Yes, so this works really well because there is no outgoing links from United States to any move. If you consider the introduction.